Bob and Sheri, sponsored by Bank of America Customized Cash Rewards Credit Card. You can earn 3% cash back on online shopping, making the essentials even more rewarding. Here's Bob and Sheri.
It's the Bob and Sheri Show.
If you play it long enough, it can get to be a habit.
With Bob.
A moment ago, you said I was crazy.
And Sheri.
I thought you'd say that.
And now, broadcasting from the Palatial Bob and Sheri Studios, it's Bob and Sheri.
So if you work for Caldwell Banker Realty in Los Angeles, you just got a very interesting listing. You got a house that was built in 1931. It sits on over 2 acres of land, and it's right down the road from the Hotel Bel Air. It's in Bel Air, which is the toniest part of the Beverly Hills area. I mean, it's just beautiful. Rod Stewart has a home there, and there's just star after star that have these gorgeous homes. It's not like the flats in Beverly Hills near Rodeo Drive, where, you know, everything is very nice, but it's small lots. These are, you know, 2 acres is pretty good. This house has a pool and also 7,100 square feet. Years ago, it was owned and lived in by Arthur Freed, producer of Hollywood classics like Meet Me in St. Louis and Singing in the Rain and An American in Paris, The Wizard of Oz. He was a big, big deal. But then he sold it, and it fell into the hands of a man whose brother is pretty well known. The man's brother is no longer with us. They are looking to sell this house for $22 million. The man bought it in 1983 for what would be today $5.5 million. His name is Ibrahim bin Laden, and he is the older half-brother of Osama bin Laden.
And he's been living like among Hollywood celebrities?
The house has not been lived in for 20 years, and I am looking at it, and it looks like the house, the Beverly Hillbillies house, the mansion. It's that big. It's 7,000 square feet. And as I said, it has a pool, which has mysteriously been well-maintained. The house also, you can see, you can scroll through a gallery of pictures on realtor.com. The house has a pink-blue hue, 7 bedrooms, 5 bathrooms, 7,000 square feet. And I'm just wondering, would you consider buying that just based on the fact that it's Osama bin Laden's half brother? If you had all that money, if you have $200 million,
yeah. Because I mean, I don't want to live in a house where a terrible tragedy has happened. You know, like I don't want to live in a house where there's been a murder or a suicide or, you know, like a cult waiting to be taken off on a comet. I don't want that. But a house that was just owned by someone unsavory, yeah, I wouldn't have a problem. I mean, would you really have an issue with that? No, seriously.
Well, I don't think that he had very much to do with his half-brother, because the story goes on to say, I'm reading this in Vanity Fair, the family patriarch, of course, the father of Ibrahim bin Laden and Osama bin Laden, was Mohammed bin Laden. Listen to this. Osama bin Laden's father, Mohammed bin Laden, had 56 children and 22 wives, 22 wives, 4 at a time. I don't know how that works out. Is it a tag team sort of thing where, you know, you got 4 going, well, I think your time is up. It's time for you to move out and bring in the next 4. 56 children and 22 wives.
Mm. Well, I'm starting to see why we need so many bathrooms. I mean, that's starting to make more sense now.
Yeah, that's for sure. That's exactly for sure.
Wow. Yeah.
I mean, would you even know your siblings at all if there are 56 of them? There's got to be at least half of them you really don't know them at all.
Well, my guess too is that a lot of there's a huge age difference, right, between them, and also in that culture, you know, they would be separated, boys on one side of the compound, girls on the other.
Yeah, so, I guess
you probably wouldn't know very many of them.
How does that work with four wives at a time? You have 22 wives. I mean, do you call a meeting and say you're out and you're in, or?
I'm at a point where four wives at a time means I'm cooking dinner every 4 days. That sounds okay. I'm all right with that. I don't know what
bathrooms in the house. Yeah.
Yeah.
But the house was abandoned for 20 years. It's absolutely beautiful. It has this beautiful portico entrance. It's white wood. I mean, it's spectacular looking. What was it like in the neighborhood knowing there's nobody been living there for 20 years?
You know, I have the feeling that that's not the only house in that part of the world that is empty with caretakers and gardeners. I think there are a lot of, like, because I was reading about this in the probably 6-8 months ago. Mm-hmm. Really, really wealthy people, they buy real estate and they snap it up, and it often goes unoccupied. In fact, Oprah is selling this unbelievable property on an island in Washington State because she said, I'm so busy, I'm never going to get there. And she's selling it for like $16 million or something. She's never lived in it. Yeah. It's fully furnished, and the lights are on, and the water's running, and nobody's ever been home. So I think that happens in those neighborhoods more than we realize, maybe.
I think so, too. I mean, you can go to upscale gated communities in Florida, parts of South Carolina, and you're riding around, you're looking, and there's nobody, you know, like every fourth house, there's somebody living there. The rest of them, maybe the family comes for 3 weeks a year, if that.
Ways to get in touch with the Bob and Sheri Show. Stick your head out a window and yell, "Hey, Bob and Sheri."
Hey, Bob and Sheri!
Get the Bob and Sheri free app for your phone and leave us a talkback message.
Hey, Bob and Sheri.
Email us through the Bob and Sheri website, bobandsheri.com, or email us hello@bobandsheri.com. Call or text us at 1-888-BOB-SHERI.
Hello, Bob and Sheri.
Leave us a DM on the Bob and Sheri Facebook page, or you can just kick it old school and yell out the window.
Hey, Bob and Sheri!
Get Bob and Sheri swag in our store at bobandsheri.com.
All right, I have a little update from the road. My two kids are doing a week-long road trip camping adventure together. And can I just pause and say that before I had children, I daydreamed, because I never had a sister. I have all these brothers. I have brothers. I have stepbrothers, brothers everywhere. I have so many brothers. I have spares, not a single sister. Always one at one. So I was like, God, if I ever get to be a mom, please let me have two little girls that will grow up to be very best friends forever. And then I had two little girls, and they were as different as like night and day, and were barely spoke to each other for a couple of years in the middle school phase. And I just thought, oh my gosh, they're never going to be. They're never going to be friends. And this is making me so sad. And I would say to them, why are you like this to each other? This is your sister. This is your person who's going to be with you for your life. Well, the pandemic hit. They both got stuck doing virtual school. Wildly enough, they became besties. And it's been wonderful to see. And so here they're off on this trip together. And I can't tell you how happy it makes me that they're together, because it wasn't that long ago where this trip would have been with a friend, if it happened at all, not with each other.
Yeah, that's exactly
so,
right. So you're right.
A few days before departing on this trip, where they're camping in the van, the Starship Dancer size, and they have a tent, and they're staying at my brother's house for two nights up near Philly. Karamia got all four wisdom teeth out. So here's today's update from the road. Now, I sent her on this trip with her post-op instructions and her medicine and everything else that she needs. And, you know, detailed explanation of do this, don't do that. If this happens, you know, blah, blah. So I checked in about 10 minutes ago. How's it coming with your teeth? And Karamia was like, well, it's kind of gross, but we're managing. And I said, tell me what that means. So Karamia, anybody that's had their wisdom teeth out knows that you have to like do like a saline rinse with a little syringe. Now, that's easy to do in your bathroom or kitchen. It's a little trickier to do in a van in the middle of a campground with no cell phone service. So they bought a jug of distilled water and a thing of sea salt. And they put the distilled water and the salt in a mason jar, and they put it on the dashboard and let the sun warm it. Then they shake it, and then she syringes it and spits it out the window of the car.
Wow.
And so I just want to say, I feel sorry for anyone that isn't raising two dainty little debutante ladies like I am.
I mean, what after she spits it out, what happens? One of them takes the whip and hits the horses and off goes the Conestoga wagon?
Seriously. Now, my husband is overcome with the giggles with all of this because leading up to this trip, so Kevin's been camping since he was a little boy. Leading up to this trip, he's thinking like about, you know, camping and survival. And the two of them are thinking about which episodes of JoJo's Bizarre Adventures to download onto the computer to watch at night and what snacks to have and which blankets would be best. And he's like, what? And I said, just don't. You know that they take after me. We are not rugged wilderness people, and we don't have street smarts. We're very book smart. We don't have any kind of sense. So when they backed out of the driveway and headed off with a van full of stuffed animals and snacks,
I was really surprised because I don't see them all the time. I see them infrequently. The last time that I saw them together, they were in that period. It wasn't middle school. It was after that, where they were kind of ambivalent about one another. You know, they had their own lives. And Olivia was still the boss because she was older. And that's very sweet to see that at this point they're going to do something that's memorable.
It's absolutely wonderful. Their first the first night on the road, I was worried about them because it was their first night on the road. And now I'm going to tell you what they bought at Walmart. They bought matching grandma nightgowns and matching machetes and said to me, listen, because I was like, don't talk to strangers, don't always look for another mom, all of that. And they held up these granny nighties and the machetes and said, if you saw us wearing these and carrying this, what would you do? And I said, you know, fair enough. I'd turn and run.
I'd back away. Yeah.
That's
quite a combination.
We got morons in the news next. It's Bob and Sheri.
Bob and Sheri.
You idiot.
Here they are.
He's a moron. He's acting like a complete idiot.
Morons in the news.
Queen Elizabeth, the Queen of England, is spending the summer at her favorite holiday home, Balmoral Castle, the sprawling estate nestled in the Scottish Highlands. Each year she travels there for her annual holiday, in which she enjoys a low-profile lifestyle. She has picnics, dog walks, and hosts the rest of the family. And it turns out her efforts to slip under the radar work so well that a group of American tourists exploring the grounds, and they do open the grounds from time to time, failed to recognize her when she came across them. Her former protection officer spoke to The Times, where he revealed that the American tourist asked the Queen whether she lived in the area. She replied, She replied, I have a house nearby. And there's a picture of her with a raincoat on and like a kerchief on her head with a big smile on her face. The group reports they went even so far as to ask her, have you ever met the Queen? To which she replied, I have not, but this policeman has. And she gestured to the former officer who worked with the monarch for over 30 years protecting her. He said the group then moved on and they had no idea they were face to face talking with Queen Elizabeth II. Is that not a hoot?
You know, I've read numerous times over the years that when she's out and about in public, she not only blends, but you know, like she handles stuff like this. Like you can say something completely out of bounds to her and she just rolls with it.
You know who else did that, but in a little bit more of a snarky way, was her husband, her late husband, Prince Philip. I read in, I think it was Kitty Kelly's book, somebody came up to Philip and didn't know who he was at some big banquet somewhere. Philip didn't have on the regalia that he sometimes does. He had a suit on. And he's standing around with a couple of people drinking. And this guy comes up and joins the conversation. And so he doesn't know who anybody is. He's just trying to be sociable, this guy. And he turns to Philip and he says, and tell me what you're doing these days. And Philip said, well, I'm still married to the Queen of England. How could you recover? If you're that guy, how do you recover socially when you do that? I don't think there is any recovery.
That's the greatest moment that you could have. Yeah. I think that's awesome. Let's go to Dublin, where the heat wave that is hitting and plaguing the United States is also hitting Dublin. It is incredibly hot in Dublin. And so a business owner, a man who owns a shop, his name is Michael Flynn. He owns a mattress store. Mm-hmm. Has put up a sign in the store, and the sign says, no bra money. Due to increasing temperatures and for our own personal safety, we will not be accepting any bra money. Sorry for the convenience. Then he went on to say, due to soaring heat waves across Dublin and ongoing safe trading with social distancing, we urge all customers not to pay us from their bras. Please keep your money in your purse or handbags at all times. Yours, Mattress Mick. That's his business nickname.
Wow.
So lots of customers, this is blowing up in Dublin, and lots of customers are enjoying this on social media. One person said, a woman named Jane said, what about men with sweaty, no singling out women? Don't let them pull it out of their pockets either. Text the word moron right now to 888-262-7437. We'll send today's moron of the day directly to your phone, and you'll be automatically registered to win a bottle of People Make Me Sick, the official hand sanitizer of the Bob and Sheri Show.
Okay, this happened, I believe, in Ireland, a small town in Ireland. Police offered support and assistance to a young woman who called emergency services early in the morning because there were a suspicious pair of footprints right in front of her front door. Senior Sergeant Craig Dennison said officers were called to her property, and they took a look at what was going on, and there was a salt-like material and footprints in this salt-like material right in front of the doorway. They investigated the scene. They brought in experts. They did a security check, and they determined that the footprints were the woman who was living at the house. They were her own footprints. Six policemen to find out it was her own footprints. How embarrassing. That's it. That's Morons in the News for today, my friends. We hope you enjoyed it. It's Bob and Sheri.
Swag you can use. Just hit shop at bobandsheri.com.
Ooh, I haven't told you guys this. So my girlfriend Tina, her family and friends threw a surprise birthday party for her. And it was awesome because she was totally surprised. And I wanted to go because I love her. And so I went, and I went by myself. And I really didn't, there were going to be a lot of people there that I didn't know from other parts of Tina's life. And I was looking forward to meeting everyone. And so I get there, and it's in a private room at a restaurant. And there weren't that many people there. So it wasn't like this big, crazy mass gathering. It was very cozy. And so I'm meeting people, and this woman comes up to me and she goes, hi, I am so glad to meet you. I'm so-and-so. I went to prom with your husband. It was my husband's high school girlfriend, not just his prom date, his first love. My husband's first love was at this party. And I was like, oh, it is so nice to meet you. So we were chatting, and I liked her. In fact, I just loved her. All of Kevin's women that I meet, he certainly has a type. I really liked this one. So we're talking about, you know, her life, and she's asking me questions about Kevin, his family. She didn't know that his parents had passed. And so I'm getting her all up to speed. And this guy comes over, and he's like, oh, I see that you two met each other. And Lane goes, I went to prom with her husband and we all had a big laugh. And I said to the guy, will you do me a favor? Take our picture, please. So he takes a picture of the two of us.
You are so devious.
Oh, wait, you don't even know. Giant smiles. And I mean, just really, really enjoyed getting to know her and chatting with her. Would love to see her again. Mm-hmm. And I have the picture and I'm waiting. I'm not going to do anything with it. I'm waiting for the text I know is going to come from my husband checking in with me. Everything okay? Having a good time? Let me know when you leave. That's something that we do. Like, I'm on my way home so that, you know, if you don't show up, right? Let me know when you leave, XXOO. So I replied back, having a great time. I just met the most interesting person. And I sent the picture and just waited.
So how long before you got a response?
30 seconds. And the response was, what?
You know, big ups to her, because sometimes you're unrecognizable years later. Obviously, she's stayed in good shape.
Oh, he knew immediately who it was. Mm-hmm. And she said to me, now she's like, I guess the organizer of all of the high school reunions, and said to me, now, why does Kevin never come to any of the reunions? I want to see him at the next reunion. And I was like, Lane, he didn't come to this party tonight. The chances of him showing up at a high school reunion are about zero. And she's like, nonsense. You tell him I expect to see him at the next one. So I said, Kev, your girlfriend expects to see you at the next reunion. And he's like, I'm not going to a high school reunion. Send me another picture.
Wait. He asked for another picture of her?
He sent me, of the two of us, sent me another picture. Yeah. So I sent another picture. And he was like, damn, his mind was blown. They haven't seen each other.
I can't even
tell you how long it's been since they've seen each other. So
God, I'm just thinking back to when I was in a prom. Oh, my God. If she showed up, that would be just a mind blower.
It would be mind blowing for me, too. It's such a small world sometimes. You know, it's just such a small world. And the fact that I didn't realize that she knew my friend Tina. It turns out my friend, so Kevin's high school girlfriend is a teacher. Mm-hmm. And my friend Tina used to be in education. And Lane was her. She was Lane's teaching assistant. That's how small the world is. Isn't that crazy? So here I'd heard the stories and I've seen the yearbook pictures, and she was, Kev's girlfriend was the captain of the cheerleaders. Like, you know, it was like this high school musical level.
Did she say what she was doing now?
She's a teacher. She's a school teacher.
She's still a teacher. Oh, okay. Mm-hmm.
And she takes care of her mom. We talked about, you know, what it was like teaching she teaches elementary school kids, and how difficult it was for the kids and for their parents who are trying to work from home doing remote schooling. And she told me all about her mom, who's 89. It was just so cool to have that encounter. But the really like jackpot moment of the night was you have to be patient and wait for your moment. The jackpot moment was, I'm having a blast. Send.
Oh, you are
here
evil.
Here comes the picture.
You are so evil. It's fun.
Straight ahead, we're going to take you down the rabbit hole, the five stages of Costco. We've got comedian Joey Callahan today, and we've got news about testosterone. Everything you think about, you know about it, guys. Everything you think is important about it might just be completely wrong. It's all coming up. It's Bob and Sheri.
Do you own or rent your home? Sure you do. And I bet it can be hard work. You know what's easy? Bundling policies with Geico. Geico makes it easy to bundle your homeowners or renter's insurance along with your auto policy.
And it's a good thing, too, because you already have so much to do around your home. Go to geico.com, get a quote, and see how much you could save. It's Geico easy. Visit geico.com today. That's geico.com. It's a fact that a child's body temperature rises 3 to 5 times faster than an adult's, and leaving a child in a hot vehicle can lead to their death very quickly. Sadly, in 2020, 24 children died of pediatric vehicular heat stroke. Many of these incidents occurred when parents or caregivers simply forgot the child was in the car. Unintentionally leaving a child in a car is a tragedy that can happen to anyone. Please set yourself reminders on your cell phone or place something you'll need in the back seat to help you remember that your child is still in the car. If your partner or caregiver is taking your child to daycare, check with them or the child care staff to make sure that the child was dropped off. And when you've arrived at your destination, always check to make sure the car is empty. Heat stroke deaths are preventable when adults take the proper precautions. Be safe and always look for baby before you lock. Paid for by NHTSA.
It's the Bob and Sheri Store's sizzling summer sidewalk sale. Everything in stock is on sale, 10% off.
10% off!
Including Sheri Lynch's cookbook, Cooking with Cats. And swag you can use, like Bob and Sheri 24-ounce latte mugs, travel mugs, H2Go water bottles. And our very hot line of mother of all mothers merch, including tote bags, candles, wear around tee and sleeve shirts.
10% off.
It's the sizzling summer sidewalk sale. Everything is 10% off. Just hit shop at bobandsheri.com and use the discount code podcast at checkout. Bob and Sheri, sponsored by Bank of America Customized Cash Rewards Credit Card. You can earn 3% cash back on online shopping, making the essentials even more rewarding. Here's Bob and Sheri.
Bob and Sheri, go.
We are big fans of the Holderness family. They're just the most beautiful people, and they're super funny and talented. And when I saw this one hit my YouTube, I LOL, as the kids say, because it's my life, and it just so spoke to me and all of the thousands of countless Costco zombies just like me. Here we go.
I really don't think we need a Costco membership.
Yeah, Costco's for like doomsday preppers.
Well, people in offices that buy brownie bites for the break room.
Like, I don't need to buy my socks in bulk.
I know, right?
Don't they sell food you get for a bomb shelter?
Like freeze-dried beef stroganoff? Hard pass.
I don't know if I want to get my IPAs from Kirkland brand.
And where would we even put that much toilet paper?
I don't know, but we definitely don't need a 20-pound wheel of cheese.
That sounds very binding.
Okay, fine.
We'll just go real quick just to check it out.
But I'm not going
to
be that guy who goes there for five things and walks out with like 40.
We're just going to stock the freezer.
You are making me eat a lot of salad now. I guess if it's cheaper to get it there, well, yeah, sure.
The kids go through fruit like crazy.
I guess we can get some eggs.
And there's a whole wine situation everyone's talking about.
You know what we do need a lot of? Batteries. So definitely get batteries.
Five things. In and out.
Do you think we need a cart?
No,
right?
We need like five things.
These things are huge.
No.
Yeah, let's start.
We're gonna need a cart. I'm sorry. They sell yoga pants here? I heard Lululemon actually makes these. Add to cart.
16 pairs?
Yes.
I mean, I may never have to buy socks again.
And it's gonna cut down on laundry? Honey, they have your vitamins here. Do you think you'll take 400 before they expire in August?
That's a pretty good price on hummus. That's a pretty good price on tzatziki.
Pretty good price on charcoal.
That's a real good price on Funyuns. This is an amazing price for 40 drumsticks.
I mean, we should definitely get paper towels, right?
Yes.
I mean, should we just get two?
Definitely.
I mean, while we're here.
That way we have it. You know what? Why not get a giant tub of pretzel snacks?
I know, right?
That sounds fun, right?
Should we get two?
Well, $4.99 for chicken? You know, we should get like 7 of these, right?
Yes. We do need a new couch. This one comes in a box, but I'm not going to question it. Girl Scout Thin Mint Almond.
You're blowing my mind right now.
It's practically a health food.
Honey, that's a great deal on pepper spray.
Yes, let's totally get it.
This could be you.
I don't even really jog, and I don't leave the house, but that's an amazing idea. A Disney sleeper set. Do you know how much money they charge for this at the parks? I'll show them.
Honey, for $80, $100 of ham.
Should we get a new mattress?
I don't like it.
I mean, ours is only 2 years old, but should we?
I love it.
It'll totally fit in the car. Honey, fireworks.
Oh, yeah.
Aren't they illegal in our state?
Probably. Get them in there. What? An atomic wall clock?
Yes.
That shows you where the constellations are?
You know, I've been looking for something like that.
It tells time with atoms.
It's practically magic.
We will always know where Cassiopeia is.
That's my favorite constellation. You know, we need a place to keep our passports. It can fit on your side of the closet. I know we don't even play golf, but if we did, we would have them. It would just be nice to have.
Honey, this is the best deal on kitty litter I've ever seen. I know we don't have a cat.
We should totally get a cat.
We should get one.
I mean, for the deal. We can't afford not to buy a cat. Convertible chase lounge.
Stop it.
It's a chair. It's a cart. It's a boat.
By stop it, I mean keep going.
Look at the size of those wheels.
I don't want to carry my chair.
When would we not use this?
Carrying things is stupid.
Should we get two?
Yep. Honey, an inflatable stand-up paddle.
I'm going to stop you right there.
put it in the car.
Do they not have bags?
What am I going to do with all this beef jerky? Just a lot of rolling around beef jerky in the back seat? It'll be fine.
Yeah.
Totally fit.
No.
Is it important that we see out of the back window?
No.
No.
Do you remember why you bought that?
I don't remember why I bought this. No!
I don't, like, where, how are we supposed to?
Perfect. They really should give you bags. This isn't fitting. If we just take him out?
Take him out of the box.
Double take the outie.
So you just can't put anything else in.
Nope. Okay. Hold on. We didn't even get anything on our list.
I think we need to go back.
Okay. Can we bring the big car?
Why?
It says here you can buy coffins.
Whoa.
I mean.
Sure.
You're going to need it.
I'm basically dying.
Just to have it on hand.
One of my ideas from Kirkland, Brand.
That is the Holderness family and the five stages of Costco. We'll post that up on the Bob and Sheri Facebook page so you can watch it for yourself. Coming up, we have comic Joey Callahan. We have an episode of Things Bob Didn't Know and Stuff Women Hate About Their Clothes. It's all straight ahead. It's Bob and Sheri.
The Oddcast. Stuff we wouldn't, couldn't, or shouldn't say on the show. Sent directly to your phone by texting Oddcast to 888-BOB-SHERI.
I have downloaded a new app onto my phone that I think demonstrates the remarkable human ingenuity and technology. It's like the perfect meeting point of human ingenuity and technology and cats. It's called Tabby. And what you do, Bob, is you take a picture of your cat's face and the app will diagnose your cat's mood and well-being based on their ear position, their head position, their muzzle tension, whether or not their eyes are narrow, their whiskers. And it uses the technology is based on the feline grimace scale, which is used to be accurate in diagnosing pain in cats. So according to the app developers, the app has 97% accuracy if you take a really high quality full face picture of your
cat. I'm taking a picture of myself on my phone and using the Bob Grimace scale. and it's off the charts right now.
I just love that.
What an app. You know, I can't even get Google Maps to talk to me half the time. I think I would struggle with this. Wow.
I just love that we have this technology and this kind of stuff exists. And it made and the fact that it's for cats extra makes me laugh because their faces, except my cats are very expressive and I can read their faces. Their faces are typically kind of like they just sort of stay the same all the time. But I saw the best tweet about cats the other day, and I wish I had taken a screenshot, but it basically went like this. Cats are amazing animals. Basically, a cat will just show up at your house and decide that it wants to live there, and you'll go buy food and litter and toys for it, and you'll just accept it. Who's the superior creature?
No, I totally agree.
And I just thought about all the people.
All about serving them. It's like having a house guest that never goes away that wants. I mean, I'm not anti-cat. Mary has one. We have one. I take care of Kitty. But cats really are superior intellectually to dogs. And I love dogs.
I just love that there are so many people that I know personally who are like, well, I guess we have a cat now. That is an amazing thing that animal can do.
You remember Tigger?
Can't really.
Landon found Tigger when she was like 8 years old underneath a deck at a neighbor's house. And it was just left there. It was all alone. And all of a sudden, Tigger became the family cat. And Tigger was pissed off 24/7, but stayed with us forever.
Because Tigger had decided that's where you're going to go. I saw that's where Tigger was going to go. I saw a really funny thread on, I don't remember if it was Reddit or BuzzFeed or whatever. It was pictures of people with pet doors who came home and found cats that aren't their cats in their house. And in some of these cases, the cat just decided that it liked this house better than wherever it came from. So strange cats just coming through the door and making themselves at home. Imagine if people did that. Now, I know that occasionally morons in the news, we do have that, where someone wakes up and there's a stranger eating their food and sleeping on their couch. But just think about what it must be like to be a cat, where you just decide, yeah, is that the Lacey's house? I think I'm going to go live there now. And you know, accept
the ability, it. The ability to figure it out is pretty amazing. I mean, it's driven probably by the need for food and water and shelter, right? I mean, they want to survive. But the idea that they could figure out, what's this little door here? Where does this go? And they get into your house. That's amazing.
Well, and that they decide, because they're really smart, they decide that you are not dangerous, that you make good servant material. That's basically what it comes down to. Like, Tigger looked around at y'all and went, oh, yeah, this place right here. This one. That guy that's all the time telling me he's not a cat person, he's going to wait on me hand and foot and pay my vet bills. I'm staying.
It's true. It's true. You know, I buy Mary's cat, and that's what it's going to be referred to, because that cat is 14 years old and was with them way before me. Like three, 4 years.
Been with them for over 10 years.
I know. But I have, I buy these things, this kitty litter boxes called the Wonder Box. And I'm checking out one time and I've got like four of them. They're $2 a piece and it's biodegradable. So I bought four of them. And this woman in line says, what's that? And I said, it's the Wonder Box. It's for a cat. It's for cat litter. And she says, why do they call it a Wonder Box? And I said, because I wonder how I got stuck doing this. That's how, and everybody laughed, because they know that there are many, many guys like me in that situation where they inherit the wife's cat or the daughter's cat, and we end up taking care of the cats. I'm back with Tigger. Kiki will only eat a certain type of food now because she's old and she's lost a couple of teeth. I have been going to the grocery store trying to find the exact sort of cat food that she wants. And I've been throwing away money in the process, because I'll open it up. Let's try the salmon. Do you like the salmon? She walks away.
Oh, yeah.
That's okay. Yeah. That's okay. Let's try the filet of chicken. Oh, you don't like that? I swear God, Sheri, I've dropped probably 15, 20 bucks doing this in the last week.
It sure sounds like that's not your cat. The app is called Tably, T-A-B-L-Y. Why don't you download that and take a picture of Kiki's face, and then that'll help you know whether or not the food is right.
Something yeah, I need to do that. About. You're right.
Straight ahead, comic Joey Callahan. It's Bob and Sheri.
Leave us a talkback with the free Bob and Sheri app.
It's time for Everyone Needs a Laugh. Here is comedian Joey Callahan.
Not a ninja, I'm a FOD. Any other FODs out here? My rap name would be Notorious FOD, Father of Daughters. Anybody have daughters? I live with all women. I got it down to a science. I just wake up and apologize to the first one I see. I'm sorry, what was I thinking? No, you're right, I don't listen. No, you're right, we should do it your way next time. I clearly don't know what I'm doing. You know, you're right, I will. I have two daughters. I get a lot of this in my house. My buddy has sons. I go, what's it like raising boys? He goes, it's easy. Just know how to hang drywall. I go, why? He goes, they're either going to run into it or you're going to shove them into it. Just know how to replace drywall. My daughters are like the raptors in Jurassic Park. One gets your attention, the other one attacks from behind. I do things to torture them. This past summer, I put my golf shirt on inside out, and we went to the mall. And I just waited. All of a sudden, I go, Dad! Your shirt's inside out! It's the way the kids are wearing it. Just keep moving. Got my older daughter, Emma Frances Callahan. She is a millennial. They're fun. She's 23, but when she was born with colic. She cried all the time. People go, oh, that was tough. When did it stop? I said, she's 23. I'll keep you posted. I was arguing with her, and she was indignant. She goes, you're too aggressive. I go, Emma, let me explain something to you. My father was an Irish Catholic Teamster. Do you want to see aggressive? You have no idea what aggressive is. Growing up, my father would say things to me like, you know, you're not my real son. My real son plays football for Notre Dame. I'm like, oh, what a coincidence. My real father could afford to send me there. We laugh, and then he beat me unconscious. My dad would give me Alamo beatings. An Alamo beating was if I would just shut up, he'd stop beating me. But I was going out like the Alamo. The odds were against me. My guns were a-blaring. I don't know what I did one day. He chased me up to my room. I shut the door. I put my back against the door. He literally put his fist through the door and was reaching for me like a zombie movie. My sister's in the other room going, Joey, just shut up. And of course, I gotta go, who is it?
He's funny.
That is comedian Joey Callahan. You can check him out on our website, BOPANDSHERI.com. This is Bob and Sheri.
Welcome to the Bob and Sheri store. You can stock up for summer with deals down every aisle. With Bob and Sheri swag you can use, including a really big 24-ounce Bob and Sheri latte mug, plus Bob and Sheri travel mugs and H2O Go bottles, plus our brand new Mother of All Mothers line with oversized tees, candles, enormous tote bags, and more. Just hit shop at BobandSheri.com.
Get Lamar's reviews sent to your phone and qualify for a Fandango gift card. Text MOVIE to 888-BOB-SHERI.
Well, I have exciting news. My daughter got the job at the artisanal soap making place that she interviewed for. I mentioned it on the show. I think it
was the first building block in her career with artisanal soap.
She left for her job interview and said, how does this look for my job interview? And I was like, well, you look like you live under a bridge with the three billy goats gruff. Like, what are you doing? Like, go put some real clothes on. And she's like, oh my God, mother. Oh my God, stop. You're so Gen X. And I said, well, you know, good luck. What do I know? I know nothing. And of course I do know nothing because she has been hired. She'll be learning how to make and sell artisanal soap. So here's the big, that's not the big news. That's the lead up to the big news. The big news is with my daughter entering the fast paced world of the artisanal soap market, I think you can expect to see her on HGTV any day shopping for an $800,000 house. Like all those other people that you see. My boyfriend and I make artisanal soap part time. Yeah. Our budget is $800,000. And we like to entertain.
Did I tell you that I was driving through Connecticut on vacation, and I was in the middle of nowhere, and I think just outside of Cheshire, Connecticut, and I looked over, and there was this nice old Connecticut house with a shack in the back, and the sign in the front said artisanal salt makers, artisanal soap makers, and
It's a growing industry.
It must be. And I just had a feeling this was like these folks' full-time work, making artisanal soap.
Well, I think that she is born for the exciting artisanal soap game. I mean, keep in mind, this is the child that washes her face with special waterproof water. So she's very concerned about what kind of cleanliness product she uses. Mm-hmm. And, I mean, I have to say, it's a real-world skill. If civilization collapses, somebody's going to need to know how to make the soap, Bob.
Yeah, that's right. Now, you're not going to sell very much to Ashton Kutcher and Mila Kunis, because evidently they don't use it very much on their kids or themselves. But most of us do. That's great. How much does a bar of soap there cost? I'll buy a bar of soap from her.
I don't know. I don't know. It's a new business. I guess it's a startup. It's a new business. And so they won't, they're doing paid training for a while. And then the store
Is it a store? Does she work at a store or somebody's barn?
No, it's a store, but it's not open yet because they're doing paid training, and they're going to train her in the art of making artisanal soap, which, let me just say, my child, the art major, learning how to make soap. Come on. There's some practical value to that.
It sort of does lead that way. You know, it goes hand in hand, to be honest with you. I think the country is coming back. If you are investing and you are making and you are hiring people to get your artisanal soap business off the ground, something's going on out there.
And based on the fact that what she wore to that job interview, and I am not, like, I work in a business where pants are optional. So it's not like I'm over here as the president of Berkshire Hathaway or something. But what she wore to that job interview, I would not wear I wouldn't wear it to clean the house. But I was wrong, and so I'm not going to say anything anymore. Any member of this family can leave the house in whatever. Oh, I'm sorry, Kev. Is that a traffic cone you're cupping over your groin? Absolutely go to the dentist like that. Not a problem. Karami, are you draped in a lawn and leaf bag? I think that's perfect for your friend's wedding. Off you go. Have a great time. I'm not going to say a word to anybody.
But you know, there's a difference between being the receptionist at a bank, you know, where the corporate headquarters are, and someone who's going to be making soap. And probably the folks that own the business are saying, you know, that's fine. You know, as long as you're comfortable, just, you know, pay attention and learn how to make soap.
But I can't help it because I was raised by old people. And I was raised to, like, you know, iron your clothes. So when Karamia came to me with the list of things that that school recommends that they pack for their dorms, one of them was an iron. I was like, we're not buying an iron. You've never used an iron. You're never going to use an iron. The heck do you need an iron for? Karamia goes, it's on the list. I said, it's not mandatory. You don't need it to graduate. Trust me. I'm not saying a word. I'm not saying a word. Wear whatever you want. Bring mommy home some homemade artisanal soap. It's Bob and Sheri.
Bob and Sheri, sponsored by Bank of America Customized Cash Rewards Credit Card. You can earn 3% cash back on online shopping, making the essentials even more rewarding. Here's Bob and Sheri.
Talk back time. You can call or text the show 24/7 at 888-262-7437. Or you can hit us up on our website at bobandsheri.com. Or you can download our app. It's free in Google Play and the Apple Store. Just tap the little microphone. Phone and talk.
Hey Bob and Sheri, this is Brad out in Angel, North Carolina. I was listening to your best people to present to an alien race bit this morning, and I couldn't help but think, why would Betty White not be there? I mean, not only is she still alive, which I think the alien race would be like, wow, these people never die, let's not mess with them. But it's Betty White. I mean, she is just the essence of human perfection. So, yeah, I'm just saying, it's Betty White. Why not have her? She's perfect. Anyway, thank you very much. You guys have a great day.
You know what else is Betty White?
I think we have a Golden Girls guy right there.
I think you're right.
You know what else is Betty White? What? The brand of whatever it is, he's gotten his bong.
He's enjoying his life, isn't he?
He is enjoying life.
He is enjoying life.
That sounds like a smoking dope conversation.
Yeah. Now, that said, he's not wrong. I think Betty White is a very good choice.
Do you think it's going to be a situation where, because of the legalization of marijuana, there are going to be more and more people? There's like 17, 18 states where it's legal now and it's growing. Do you think we're going to be hearing more people? I'm not saying he's stoned. I mean, that could be the way the guy, you know, talks. He's a very nice guy. And thank you for listening.
Yeah, we don't know.
That covered it, Bob. I think you're okay.
Yeah, thank
now.
You. Did I get it all?
You got
okay.
it. Oh, yeah.
Okay. All right. I got a little clear checklist here that I
nice,
used.
Nice clean margins, Bob. Good job.
Thank you. Good. Good. I mean, do you think that's going to be the case where people are, you know, just going to blaze up a little bit there? And you walk into the hardware store and the man is saying, yeah, what are you looking for?
I can help you.
You know, I'm going to say no, that I have more faith in my fellow humans, because alcohol's legal. And when I walk into the Limited, Mallory isn't going, girl, it's mimosa time. You should get that. That looks good on you. Like, you know, I am giving credit to my fellow adults for their ability to manage their adult pleasures. How's that?
Really?
Mm-hmm.
I am, seriously. See, I don't know. I can see there's an attitude with some of the populace that it's a more mellow and less aggressive sort of high, and that maybe you could get away with it a little bit better. I don't know. Well, we're going to find out, because it seems to be state by state. They're going right now, whether you like it or not.
Here's my guess. The people that already, you know, wake and bake and catch a buzz before going to work will do so now legally. And the people that don't, won't.
I think you're right.
Like, at no time do I expect, when marijuana is legalized, for Max's mom to call and go, listen, sweetie, I am so wasted, right? The people that are going to use it are going to use it.
I just have to bring my mom into it.
Can you even imagine your mom high?
I can't imagine.
Oh,
that.
My God. That would cause an extinction level event across the universe if Max's mom
just,
was high.
I'm more thinking about pulling into the Dairy Queen or a fast food place, actually, and saying, I'd like to get a small cone. And the guy's baked and goes, the machine is broken again.
let me just ask you. You're not getting that now already?
Yeah, sometimes, actually.
Yeah.
Sometimes.
Okay, you just made my point. It's Bob and Sheri.
Sign up for the newsletter with Bob and Sheri exclusive articles. Sign up now at bobandsheri.com.
I was giving some thought to your question, Bob, that you asked. I thought about it during the break. Like, do I think once marijuana is legal everywhere that people will just be getting high and going to work with a buzz and all of that? I was giving that some thought. You know, I don't think they've seen that in states where it is legal. But just, here's an interesting thing to think about. So my daughter's summer job was at what we used to call a head shop, but they call them smoke shops now. It's a famous, famous smoke shop.
Oh, is that what they call them? They don't call them head shops anymore?
No. Huh. And they sell clothes and jewelry and posters and knickknacks and smoking supplies for tobacco and other things, although they're not allowed to talk about it that way because it's not legal
right
there. And they sell something called Kratom. Kratom is legal. Kratom is a tree, and the leaves from the Kratom tree, are used as like medicine and an herbal product and as a recreational drug. It's illegal in some states. It's legal in most places. People use Kratom for a lot of things. They even use it to like help withdraw from heavier drugs. People use it for depression or anxiety, but it can be really unsafe. Like, if you do a search on it, you'll see that there are people who, you know, end up very, very jacked up from Kratom use. So Kratom is legal where my daughter's job was, and they sold Kratom. And I asked her one day, I was like, who buys Kratom? And she said, it's so interesting because I can spot a Kratom customer when they come in now, because the Kratom customers look like other people's parents and like grownups who are managers of things. I was like, really? She said, yeah, like moms. Like, a lot of people who I look like book club moms come in and buy Kratom. Huh. And a lot of like grown men that are dads come in and buy Kratom. She's like, it's really weird. The Kratom people are adults.
Tell me again what it does.
It can be used as a recreational drug. I guess you can catch some sort of a high from it. I've never tried Kratom, so I don't know. But at one of my adult tap dance classes a couple years ago, there was a woman in the class, and she just was in the best mood. And I said to her, and she was a really good tap dancer. Like, she tapped as a kid. She was amazing. I was like, you're like, first of all, you're just so fun to be around, and you're an amazing tap dancer. And she gave me a big hug pre-pandemic. threw her arms around me, gave me a big hug and whispered in my ear, girl, I'm so high on Kratom, I don't know where my feet are. And I did.
Well,
like,
I mean, if it has that effect, how can it be legally sold?
I did a triple take on that because I was like, whoa, okay. I don't know, Bob, but it's for sale. It's legal in most places.
Wow.
And
I've never heard of it.
I just thought it was interesting that my kid told me that the people that buy it tend to be book club moms and people's dads. So I don't know. Max, did you know anything about it? Because I don't really know anything about it.
No, I don't know anything about it.
Well, one of the reasons that I brought up the idea that perhaps there will be people going to work stoned is the last couple of times that I've been in New York City, I wasn't going down to where the tourists were. I was, you know, walking around Madison Avenue and places like that and lesser known parts of the city. And you'd smell marijuana everywhere. And it was during the week. And so businesses were open. And these people are, you know, they're New Yorkers. They're not tourists. They must have a job somewhere. And it's daylight. And you just got to say somebody is getting baked and going to work. I don't know how they do it. And I don't think it's a good idea.
Agreed. And I don't think that we know. And I don't think we're going to know. And I suspect that over my career in radio, I have worked with some people that were higher than the moon at the time that they were in the building or in the office or whatever. You just don't always know. And you can't. You can't tell.
There was a guy that I worked with years ago, and the station that I was working for had a double-decker bus, a double-decker English bus, like you'd see in London. And he was known to smoke a lot of weed, and he was the driver of said bus. So he was sent out to pick up some people at a senior citizen center, where actually a retirement place, and they were going to go to a mall. And so they packed the mall, and both levels were filled. So it took some of these folks had trouble, you know, moving easily. So we had to wait. And he was a very nice guy, and he gets everybody in the bus, and it's probably about 50 people or something like that. And off he goes. Now, nobody ever thought that he was high when he was driving it. And we don't know to this day. But what we do know is that he took that double-decker bus and brought it down to an underground parking area and sheared the entire top of the bus off with screaming senior citizens.
Mm.
Now, I ain't saying he was stoned.
That's
but
not
he was
ideal.
Fired. He was fired.
Yeah.
That's what worry about, you know? Nobody was hurt, thank God.
The thing is, yes, you do worry about it. I don't know. We'll have to wait and see. I'd have to do a deep dive on the data in places where it's legal. I don't know. All I know is that the people all around you, your neighbors at your book club, at your job, at the grocery store, you can't tell by looking at them what they have going on.
Very often.
You cannot tell. Because my daughter told me, she's like, you wouldn't believe if you could see some of the people that come in before closing to stock up on the Kratom. She's like, you just would not believe it.
I've never heard of it. I can't believe. And I'm in media. I can't believe it. I got to get out more.
Straight ahead. Good news for men about testosterone. It's Bob and Sheri.
You read it once.
I don't believe that.
And then you read it again.
I can't believe this.
It's Bob and Sheri's.
I don't believe this.
Hey, big guy. Hey, big manly man loaded up with testosterone, swaggering around, being a success at work, a success at home, a success with the ladies. Look at you. You got so much testosterone. That's probably why you're such a big, bad, scary dude, right? Wrong. It turns out that everything we know about testosterone is incorrect. Used to be that we associated high levels of testosterone with men being more alpha, you know, more successful, right? And we do know that there is definitely a connection between testosterone and success with men who work in certain fields, like the stock market, you know, Wall Street, hedge fund traders, you know, that kind of like really aggressive way of making your living where you're fighting the world, you know, you versus everything. Mm-hmm. Those men tend to have more testosterone. So for the longest time, the assumption was men and women, but we're really talking about men here, men with higher levels of testosterone are more successful because they have that testosterone. They are alpha males because of their testosterone. But it's actually the other way around. The more successful you are, the more testosterone you'll produce. And isn't that an interesting way of thinking?
Really?
Yeah. They actually studied male executives, white collar, you know, CEO types, and they found that that men in power in the corporate world have more testosterone than their subordinates. But what they can't prove is that success is a result of testosterone. What they can look at is how testosterone is a result of success. That the more comfortable and advantageous your social and money position is, the more testosterone your body produces.
I totally believe this, and let me tell you why. Did you see the shape of Bezos's rocket ship?
Yes, I did. Yes, I did.
There you go.
The other thing is that in men, again, higher testosterone is linked to good health. And people who have better health are more likely to be more successful. And why is that? Because you're healthy and you can get out there and work and do all of those things that we associate with being like a big old dominant alpha man. And
I wonder if there's a tie into all of this and the famous quote from Henry Kissinger, the former Secretary of State under Nixon, where he said, power is the ultimate aphrodisiac.
I don't know that that has to do with testosterone, but
maybe not.
I mean, that's definitely connected. I mean,
yeah, it is connected.
People
yeah.
who have power, both men and women, seem to have an easier time getting who and what they want. Here's the interesting thing about testosterone, and this is true for men or women. Your testosterone levels are genetic, right? And your genetic code is determined before you're born. Right.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
it really doesn't change during your lifetime unless you have a mutation. That's cancer. So it's kind of like your height is genetic. No amount of you swaggering around and being the master of the universe is going to make you grow 4 inches overnight. We are bound and limited by our genes in so many ways. And that is very, very true of testosterone. So we've made this big myth about testosterone. You know, the more you have, the better you are, the more manly and successful and powerful you are. But according to the geneticists and the scientists who looked at this, they said that success comes before your testosterone levels rise, not after. Being in a more advantageous position raises your testosterone. I guess in the way that certain things impact your other hormones, right? They're not static. Certain things have an impact on hormones, and success and money and the ability to be comfortable are very, very good for a man's testosterone. So the good news here is that if you think of yourself as a dude who's not super alpha, you know, like you're not wanting to go out and kill a bear and eat it for breakfast and then take over Wall Street or whatever it is all these alpha men seem to want to do. If that's not you, no worries, because we've just made a big Hollywood cartoony myth of it. And the two things are not connected. And in fact, it's like everything else in life. If you got some money and you're comfortable, you're going to look better, you're going to feel better, and you're going to act with more confidence. Because you got enough to eat and your clothes are clean and you feel good about yourself.
And if you have lower testosterone, or LT, as we like to call it, ask your doctor if certain products are right for you.
And I can name them. All right, I'll post this up on Facebook and we'll get this out to you. It's Bob and Sheri.
instant access to the podcast and fun side. Just download the free Bob and Sheri app.
You know, as a man, I don't pay too much attention to women's clothing. If I see my wife in a pretty outfit, you know, I'll comment on that. But I read this article and I thought it was kind of interesting. Women contributed the most irritating things about women's clothing. So let me run them by you and see if you agree with some of these ladies and their opinions. The first one is see-through shirts. This woman says, I hate that so many shirts in women's clothing are thin or nearly sheer. I don't enjoy having to put a tank top on under my shirts or having my bra show through. You know, when I read that, and this was at the top of this list, I just can remember being in, I guess, high school, 10th grade, something like that. And it was always unusual. Maybe it was the time. I don't know. It was always unusual when a girl would come in and she'd have a white blouse on and you could pretty much see right through it. And she wasn't like, you know, a girl trying to hoochie it up. It was just that's what, you know, a lot of girls wore. And if she had a black bra on, it was like, hello. I just always found that to be very strange. Why would the material be so sheer? Is that a thing?
Speaking as someone who's not distracting you in math class, almost all of my white or light colored shirts have to have something underneath them. In fact, some days I feel like, because women's clothing is that way, some days I feel like that I've been wearing an undershirt since I was 4 years old, because I just routinely, and if you stop and think about it, you probably go, yeah, that's right. How often do you see me wearing just one shirt? Think about that.
Yeah. But why is my question, though, as a guy, why is that? I mean, as a 10th grade boy, I would say to myself, OK, I know what I'm looking at here and I shouldn't be doing that, but I'm not the only one. And why don't they make it a little bit thicker? You can't see through my button down shirt.
Wish I could tell you. Don't have an answer. Don't know why it's that way. It just is.
But it still is. Next lady says, plus size clothes have too much decoration on them. I don't want to look like a garden. I don't know anything, and you don't probably know anything about that either. But do you think that that's true?
I think that's true. Yeah, actually, I do.
Why would that be? Because everybody knows, you know, if you've read anything about women's clothing, like a solid black, you can't go around wearing black every day unless you're Sheri Lynch. But why would you have all of these flowers if you don't want to look like a garden?
I saw a tweet about this. Oh my God. Like years ago when Twitter was first a thing. And this woman said, why are all the clothes I'm shopping for so garish and awful? Do you think I'm trying to camouflage myself at the circus? And it's kind of that vibe. Yeah. I don't know why.
The next post is each black piece is a different shade of black. That's true, though, I think, in men's
clothing.
That's
very true. Yeah, that's very true.
So it makes it harder to, if you want to go all black, you know, it makes it harder to have a black shirt and black slacks. Next one, the crop top trend. I am tired of looking for a shirt that actually covers my belly. I like cute shirts, but I don't like how revealing they are. Is the crop top thing like having a moment or something? It's always kind of been back, hasn't it?
Yeah, it's kind of back, yeah.
Really?
And J-Lo rocked it last week in a very dramatic way that I liked a lot. She had these huge, billowy, flowy, soft. They were the biggest pair of white linen pants I've ever seen and a teeny tiny little crop top on top. So for a long time, it's been long and loose over skinny jeans, and now it's short and cropped over bigger pants. It's all cyclical.
Next one is complaining about branding. They ask customers to become walking billboards with giant logos, and unfortunately, most buyers happily oblige. I think that's true too, especially with women's clothing. It is true with men's clothing too. Pants need to come in more inseams other than short, regular, and tall. Men get all sorts of inseams. Why can't women? Is that a problem for women? Inseams?
Yes. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Our sizing is way different and limited.
Yeah. And finally, athletic clothing is always bright colors or bizarre patterns. I love dark, neutral colors, but they're so hard to find in women's options. Men's gear doesn't fit me. Is that true?
again, yeah, like, do I want to look like the galaxy just threw up on me?
Mm-hmm.
I just want to go for a run.
No, yeah. All right. Well, yeah. They were, these women were 100% with you as the backup. It's Bob and Sheri.
Now, let's open up the Bob and Sheri Archive Vault.
What do you do on the weekends?
Well, me and a couple friends usually get together and go out and find a good cow field and go shrooming.
Now, I don't know a lot about this. So you go to cow fields and you look for certain mushrooms, I guess, that get you high? Is that what it is?
Yeah, they're certain kind of shrooms.
They're what?
There's certain ones that you can eat.
How do you know what
they grow on manure, right?
Actually, yeah, it's kind of nasty, but...
They grow on manure.
That's why he's in a cow field.
They grow on cow poo.
You talk about getting blank faced. You know? Are they hard to find?
Yeah, sometimes they are.
So what do? Do you smoke them once you get them out of the cow turds?
No.
You eat them. You lick them. What do you do?
You put them up your
butt. What do you do with them?
You eat them, or you make tea out of them.
You make tea out of them.
I thought you had to dry them first.
You boil them up and. You have to make tea out of them.
How many does it take to catch a buzz?
Usually we just go out and get as many as we can. Mm-hmm. Throw about 10, 15 in a pot.
And how many people can experience the effects off of a pot of shroom tea? How many does it serve?
Depends on how big of a pot you make.
And what
usually we'll get like two or three of us together and we'll all trip off.
Now, what is the experience of drinking a fungus that has grown on cow dung? What is one experience?
I think the kettle is perking.
But my question is, ignore these people.
Hey,
ignore these people and tell me what it's like. What do you feel like and what do you experience when you drink the tea?
All right, so we usually will go out like after it's rained because you gotta get it when it's like really wet around, right?
Right, right.
So you go out, you find a good field, and you go out in the middle of the field and you just start looking for them with a flashlight. You got to actually turn the mushrooms over and look at them.
Right. Hey, John, is this what your mother and father hoped for you, that you, in your off hours, would be looking at cow crap for
my
something to get high?
My mother and father don't know a thing about it.
I'll be damned.
Well, John, we've got a great surprise for you. Your mom and dad are on line, too. We're going to join them right now.
You guys keep interrupting John. Tell me. Okay, now you make the shroom tea. Then what happens?
All right. Usually we'll just sit around and chill.
Do you see things? Do you see trails? What do you feel like?
Mostly it's just a body trip. It's really good sensations all over the body.
Do women do this too, or is it just you and your male friends?
Say what?
Do girls get involved in this, or is it just you and your male friends?
Usually, yeah.
You know, if a girl wants to go out and see that, she can go to any local bar. I got him. I got John. I got him. You know, I got to tell you, though, man, you're an easy laugh.
Rock on, man.
You are the best. You are the best, John. Y'all play music?
Usually, yeah.
Like what tunes?
Usually it's like Kendrick, Floyd, some new stuff that sometimes we'll put it on y'all station and jam out.
Yeah.
John, I have a question.
Yeah.
I don't know. I'm like Bob. I don't know anything. I'm kind of picky about what I eat, so picking some fungus off of a turd and drinking it.
Amen.
I don't mean to bring you down.
First,
yeah, it's just not my thing. I guess I'm wondering,
is it
a 12-month growing season on the poop? Or
No.
Enlighten me.
Basically what it is right after a real heavy rain, like a real big storm, they'll grow like overnight.
Do you have any worries about any long-term?
Nah.
Right.
Nah. I'm cool.
Are you stoned right now, John?
It rained last night.
Yeah, it did.
It did.
That's
it rained
rain.
Last night. John, you're a bad boy. You know that?
Shame on me, man. Shame on
you. Oh, wait. It's...
Jeez, John. This, yeah, we're laughing, but this is not good. You can kill yourself, man. Get the wrong shroom.
No, man. I've never done that.
Well, yeah.
How long?
Yeah, because you're still alive. Yeah, how that's long? How it worked.
How long you been doing this, John?
Just a few years.
Oh, and your parents have no idea this is going on?
Well, they don't know that I shroom. They know that I smoke.
Oh, they know you smoke pot?
Yes.
Are they okay with that, or are they just resigned
to it? Not really,
No.
They live in Florida, man.
Oh, that's right. The whole state's stone. What was I thinking? All right, listen. John, I'm going to say a prayer for you today and Sunday, all right?
Rock on, man.
That's not really the response I was looking for. Bye, John.
You can hear more from the Bob and Sheri archives at bobandsheri.com.
Instant access to the podcast, and fun side. Just download the free Bob and Sheri app.
You know, America's just an amazing country. And nobody agrees with that statement more than Chinese billionaire Sun Dawu. Sun Dawu made his money in pig farming. He's a billionaire. He got so much money. He's not riding a questionably shaped rocket to the fringes of outer space, though. And he's not explaining to people why it is he doesn't pay income taxes. That's what American billionaires do. Nope. Prominent Chinese billionaire Sun Dawu has been sentenced to 18 years in prison. Are you ready? For picking quarrels and causing trouble.
That sounds like he's complaining about the government. Is that what they're doing? That sounds like a trumped up thing right there.
Yes. Yeah. He praised his lawyers during a government crackdown on various things, and he organized an attack on government officials. That's what they're accusing him of. And also picking fights with them and causing trouble. He's also been fined about close to $500,000 in American. He's been convicted of gathering people to attack government entities, obstructing public affairs, sabotaging production, illegally occupying farmland, which is his own farmland, illegally taking public money, picking fights, and provoking trouble. If you could go to jail in America for picking fights and provoking trouble, we would have no one. We'd have empty news sets on all the cable channels.
That is definitely the case. Yeah, that's all trumped up stuff. I'm not saying this is a good guy. I don't know who he is outside of the fact that he's rich, but he is applying pressure as a very wealthy man, businessman, and that's what they do. They trump up these charges. Are they going to try to throw him in jail? Or they're just
for 18 years? No, 18 years.
Oh, that's right. You said that. Yeah, 18 years. Good Lord.
And according to the BBC, this guy is believed to be close to prominent political dissidents. He's criticized government policy. He's been outspoken about human rights. He's one of the few people to publicly accuse the Chinese government of covering up an outbreak of swine flu back in 2019. Mm-hmm. Now, keep in mind, he made his billions as a pig farmer. So for him to blow the whistle on the swine flu, that kind of tells you about his integrity. And now he will not be riding a questionably shaped rocket to the stratosphere. He'll be going to prison for 18 years.
It seems wrong, doesn't it? I mean, I thought that eventually we would become friends with China, but we are not, and they don't want to be our friends, and they are working to stagnate our economy and cause trouble for us everywhere. Look what they did in Hong Kong. They've got this guy Xi who runs the country, and he has this really grandfathery sort of look. Have you seen the guy? I mean, he looks like a very nice grandfather of somebody. He's a murderer.
I don't know
why they don't want to be friends with us. We're nice enough people, aren't we? I mean, I think we're pretty nice people.
They don't want to be told what to do. They want to dominate. They want to make sure that America is not the leading power for the rest of this century. That's what they're going after. And they're spending a lot of money on education. They're spending an awful lot of money on military. And, you know, the taking over of Hong Kong.
Well, I know that this billionaire, Sundar Woo, wishes he was in America, where if you are good at picking quarrels and causing trouble, you get a multi-million-dollar, multi-year deal at CNN, and you get to ride a questionably shaped rocket to the stratosphere. USA!
It's true.
If these people had some frozen custard sometime, you know, just something simple like that, maybe they'd they'd like to be our friends. I think it's
important. Go to a NASCAR race.
There,
you know, see a baseball game.
Right. No drive-through ice cream, though, because the last thing we need is to lure them over here for some detente, and then they're told the machine is broken. That'll just feed every narrative they have about America.
That's right. Oh, America's a broken-down society. It doesn't work. Democracy doesn't work anymore. That's shocking.
It's Bob and Sheri.
Get Lamar's reviews sent to your phone and qualify for a Fandango gift card. Text MOVIE to 888-BOB-SHERI.
And now on the Bob and Sheri Show, it's another exciting episode of Things Bob Didn't Know.
Thank you very much, Max. There's several running inquiries on the Bob and Sheri Show. We just kind of muse about them publicly. One of them is, why our fathers were so out of control? Why can't we win a Marconi Award as the best syndicated radio show in the country, been nominated and lost 10 times, and so on and so forth. And another one is, what do you think our relatives, our ancestors did in ancient times? We are sure they were not part of the royal family or the court. They were probably way lower at the bottom of the barrel. And that brings me to something that I just read. The pharaohs of ancient Egypt were believed to be literally divine. The word pharaoh itself means great house, as in the house of God. In fact, King Pepi II, and I just love his name, P-E-P-I.
King Pepi is a great rapper name.
Isn't that, you are right.
King Pepi.
Oh my, that is one of the most creative ones I've ever heard.
Why is there no King Pepi?
There should be. King Pep, that's a great name for a rock star, for a radio guy. King Pepi in the morning.
King Pepi in the morning. You know what? Oh, to be able to go back in time. If you could have been King Pepi.
Yeah. Now, what would you be? Queen what?
Just queen. Thanks.
Yeah.
Queen works.
She's just the queen. Yeah. Oh, something you're used to. That's good. So anyway, listen to this. King Pepi II, who supposedly ruled for 90 years. Boy, I tell you what, Pepi must have been eating right. Thought so highly of himself that when he was bothered by insects, he would command that one of his slaves be covered head to toe in honey to lure the flies away from Pepi. That would be my job. That would be your job.
Covered in honey and human fly trap?
A human fly trap, and just, you know, be sitting there, you know, in the barn or wherever we are, and then the knock would come. Yeah. Pepe's going out today. Oh, geez. Are you kidding? He wants you. What is he wants the honey? Oh, jeez. And we'd have to strip naked and be covered with honey and walk, you know, like maybe 10 or 15 feet from Pepi.
You know what would happen, Max? Because Max would be back here in this timeline with us too, right? Living in the stable with us. And Bob would come back from a long shift of being King Pepe's human fly trap. And he would finally get scrubbed off in, like, I don't know, a horse trough. And he would be saying to me and Max, it's just, you know, when I was a kid, I used to look at these hieroglyphics and I thought I'd be living in a penthouse apartment, like in Manhattan, and working as a secret agent. Not that I would be covered in honey to collect flies for King Pepi.
God, what would happen to the guy if a fly landed on Pepi and your job is to attract them? That's the end of you.
He would get executed, and then Pepi would bring Max in to replace you. Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's what would happen.
And he would, and Max is taller, so there'd be more land to cover with the honey. Yeah, that's what would happen to me.
I think it's I think it's the best possible self-awareness to know that you were not the Pharaoh. Your ancestors were not the Pharaoh. They were the Pharaoh's flytraps. I just think it keeps you humble if you're honest about where you come from.
You think the Pharaoh ever said anything? Do you think Pepi ever said anything to the guy covered in honey?
No, because here's the thing about being the Pharaoh part of that gig. They're not regular people. They don't have to be of the people. They are godlike creatures chosen by the gods to rule.
Right, right, right.
Do you ever go outside and apologize to a cockroach for how you're treating it? No. Pepi.
I've had therapy.
King Pepi would barely consider you a human being.
Yeah.
And if you spoke, he would probably have your tongue cut out.
I'll bet the really powerful pharaohs had like four guys covered in honey.
Oh, yeah. That's not
what
a
lowly thing. What a lowly thing to do. You get one pass in life and you're stripped naked and you're walking next to this guy, Pepi, covered in honey to attract insects.
Okay, but wait, there's another way to look at this that you're not considering.
That you're near the king, that you're near Pepi, screw him.
You see this with modern American eyes. But supposing that you come from a family, generations upon generations of people whose entire job was to collect dung and form it into bricks. And for some reason, you were singled out by the Pharaoh's people as an excellent candidate to be a human flytrap. And now you're getting better food and better lodgings, and you're in proximity to the gods.
Royalty, yeah.
Yeah.
That's a good way to look at it. Yeah.
For someone that's worked in this business, the fact that you can't spot an opportunity when one is coming right at you, come on.
You know what would happen to me, though? I'm stripped naked. I'm covered in the honey. I'm walking in the desert because Pepi wants to see, you know, a pyramid or something. Flies and gnats are all over me. It's like 8 hours of that. And I go back to wherever I live. And they scrub me down. And finally, that's off. And there's that knock again. Pepi wants to go out tonight.
It's just when I was a kid, I looked at these hieroglyphics and I thought I would travel the world on a Viking boat. But no, I'm Pepi's flytrap.
Right.
It's Bob and Sheri.
Get the moron of the day by texting moron to 888-BOB-SHERI.
Okay, so we were just talking about the ancient Egyptian pharaoh, King Pepi. That was
the second
real name.
King Pepi the second. He was a real guy. And he didn't like insects on him, and so he would have a slave covered in honey, naked, covered in honey, walking near him, so that the bugs would go on the slave, attracted by the honey.
And so Bob was just kind of accepting that if his ancestors were Egyptian,
that's their gig.
Bob would be descended from a long line of human flytraps and not the pharaohs. So. Yeah. You have to remember that this is a great job for a young boy back then, because you would be lifted out of poverty. You would live in the palace with the pharaoh. You'd have better food. You'd have a better place to sleep. Now, there's a catch to all of this, because from everything I've read and seen on like the History Channel, when the pharaohs died, their entire household staff was murdered and entombed with the pharaoh to serve him in the afterlife. So, Bob, as King Pepi's human flytrap, you're going to want to be real, real sure that he doesn't get stung by something that could kill him, because that's the end of you, too.
You don't want to knock on the door just as you get the honey off of you after having walked in it for hours. Yeah, what is it? Are you kidding? Pepi's not feeling well. Are you kidding me? What's wrong with him? He's got the dysentery. You want me to do what? To go with you? Where are we going? I'll find out.
Take a ride in the car.
Take a ride in the car. A ride in the chariot.
you know what, you guys? This is a perfect example of the saying tragedy plus time equals comedy. Because back then, when the flytrap was being hauled off to be sent to the afterlife with the Pharaoh, there's nothing funny about that. There's not even a little bit.
You know what? Here's what I would do, though, because, you know, I can think of my feet pretty good. They go, all right, stand over there. We're going to beat you to death. Listen, before you do that, is he really sick? He's really, really sick. He's going to be dead by tomorrow. And so you got to go today. But he ascends to heaven, right? Yeah. Yeah. Well, there wouldn't be any insects in heaven. There wouldn't be any flies up there because it's heaven. There's the little bluebirds, you know, clouds. The bluebirds are flying around. So you don't need to kill me.
You're going to be beaten twice as hard for your insolence. Because the Pharaoh may not need a fly trap in heaven. But just shut up and get in the pyramid.
Yeah, one of the executioners is going to say, you know, he's probably right. I'm just so tired of hearing him. Let's just beat him to death. Hey, I've had program directors felt the same way.
Can you imagine how awful it must have been back then to know that, oh man, I've got this really good job with the Pharaoh in the palace, but if anything happens, I'm going to have to go to the afterlife with the Pharaoh. Yeah. And then you don't have no matter how good a person you were as the human flytrap.
Yeah, you're not.
You're not in paradise. You're a servant for all eternity to King Pepi. And the Bob, the kind of person that dips a young boy in honey and turns him into a flytrap, you think that's somebody you want to serve for all eternity?
Yeah.
Did you ever think about that before you took the job? I don't think so.
See, that's the thing with jobs, you know. There's always a... These days... There's no insurance in a lot of jobs, and that's horrible. But at least you got a job and you don't have to die.
The fact that the best thing we can say about most jobs now is, well, you won't be slaughtered to serve the Pharaoh in the afterlife.
That's true.
That's not awesome.
It's true. There's no retirement. There's no dental. There's no medical.
You won't need retirement, dental, or medical because you're going to be slaughtered to serve.
You're
going to
be beaten to death. Yeah, right.
It's Bob and Sheri.
Hey, thank you so much for listening to the Bob and Sheri podcast and the Bob and Sheri Oddcast. We would love if you would subscribe, rate and review, and share it with a friend on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, wherever you go. And thank you again for listening.
Fox Hunter is a new true crime podcast series from Imperative Entertainment. I'm your host, Sean Kipe. Join me as I investigate what really happened to 18-year-old Rhonda Sue Coleman on the night she was brutally murdered. Together, we'll pore through 30 years of lies, deception, and corruption to finally get to the truth. And what I've uncovered will leave you on the edge of your seat. Subscribe now to Fox Hunter. Listen wherever you get your podcasts.